Okay, guys. I think if I did it the right way, you should see my blue desktop, right? So welcome. Today's, are you going to let the people in, Chris, from now on?
Yeah, just all would change my view.
Okay. So welcome to another session of XSharp Online. Today, the session is a bit has a bit of a funny name about unboxing, because that's what all these YouTube influencers do, right? They demonstrate new products and they're going to unbox it. So I thought we could probably do something like that as well today. So I'm going to start, and in the meantime, you all know installers take a bit of time. While it's installing, I'm going to explain a bit about what we did for 2.8 and why it took so long, because it really did take longer than most of the other updates. Let me run this. As you can see, this machine has 2017, 2019 build tools and 2019 professional. For those of you who are running continuous integration servers, we made sure that we now detect the build tools. So you do not have to have Visual Studio installed on your build server. Build tools itself will work, and we will integrate into build tools. So that may be useful for people doing CI/CD servers. Why did it take so long? Well, actually, we did a lot of changes in this 2.8 build. The two most important changes is that we switched from an older version of Roslyn to the latest version of Roslyn. And the latest in this case means the version from January 2021. And in the meantime, the people from the Roslyn team made lots and lots of changes, started changing folder structures, deleted files, split files, combined files. It was really the merge process from GitHub wasn't able to cope with that, so we had to do some manual merging. That's the first change we did. The second change, which cost quite some time, was that we moved some stuff in Visual Studio from synchronous to asynchronous to help improve performance of editing in Visual Studio, and also to be prepared for newer versions of Visual Studio. As a result, we are also dropping support now for Visual Studio 2015, so we will no longer support that. Did some questions on the forum, and apparently no one was really using 2015 anymore, so that's great. I'm not going to install XIDE because, as you can see, it's already on my desktop, but I do want to open what's new, and I recommend you have a look at that too, because as you can see, there are about 8 pages of changes. Over here, we're on page, well, it doesn't show it, but it's page 7 or page 8. It's really a lot. So we make changes almost everywhere. And we do recommend, if you're going to work with 2.8, give it a good test. I hope you guys have test suites, because we made so many changes, it's very likely that we've broken something. And what I want to show at the first is that we did indeed break something, and we broke something in the compiler, sorry, in the installer. So what I'm going to do now on my test machine is first show you what you can do yourself too, to make sure that you're really loading the right version of the compiler. I did post a message on our forum about it, but what happened is that we accidentally included a incorrect version, or by say an older version of the compiler DLL. The what we call the full macro compiler includes the compiler, that's why it's the full macro compiler. And this has version or build number 10 of 2.8 included, but we want to have build number 11. And on top of that, it's not just build number 10, but it's also a debug version of build 10. So some issues that were reported on the forum are because of the fact that it's a debug version, and debug versions show assertion dialogues when something looks incorrect, And the error that was reported by Danilo this week, where he used the X-sharp namespace with a lower X, lowercase x, it's not really a bug, but it's something unexpected. And that's why this debug assertion is shown, but it's not really a problem. But you will see this message because we have a debug version installed. Now, what you to solve this, you need to open Windows, Microsoft.net. I was going to the wrong one already. Assembly, GEC MSIL, and go to the end. And remove X-sharp code analysis. You can just delete it if you're a local admin. This is not the recommended way by Microsoft to clear things from the GEC, but it works and it's very, very easy. And you also remove X-sharp scripting. If you do that, then you know that your compiler is going to really use the latest build 11 and not using build 10. If you want to make sure that's right, you can always open the command prompt. Our installer installs the compiler in the path, and if you type xsc, the X-sharp command line compiler, you should see version 2.8.0.11 release. If you do not see that, then you haven't deleted the code analysis DLL from the GEC. I probably should have shown you this before I deleted it, but if you see this, then things are okay. Good. So why did it take so long? Roslyn changes, run VS change, and on top of that, we also did quite some runtime changes and new compiler features, and we added a first version of runtime debugging support. Now, what I want to do now is demonstrate some of this stuff in Visual Studio, and while doing that, I want to also show you some of the new things we did inside Visual Studio. So we're going to mix it a bit. So we have topics with regard to the language, Visual Studio, runtime, etc. I did a few small test projects in my unboxing solution that I will upload to the forum, to the downloads area later today. Okay, now we're inside Visual Studio. What has changed? Well, if you first impression of what has changed in Visual Studio, you can go to Tools Options. Before, you had to type X-sharp to see our dialogues. Some people complained that for C-sharp, you type C-sharp, but for X-sharp, you had to type the word. Well, it took a while, but we finally figured out how to have our language appear here with X-sharp. And if you look, you will see that there's inside the text editor, we were already visible before. We now have an extra tab. We have formatting and IntelliSense. And you may see more in the future. The formatting basically has to do with formatting in the editor. So for example, the keyword case synchronization, alignment, and you will see two new options here, trim trailing white space and insert final new line. These also have to do with editor config, which I'll discuss later. IntelliSense are most of the options that have to do with IntelliSense in the editor. There's a new one here that says exclude members from other files. What we try to do, if you have partial classes, we try to show you the members regardless where they are in the combo boxes. But if you have partial classes spread over dozens of files, that could actually slow down things a bit. And in that case, you may want to select this option to just show you the partial the members of partial classes from the current file. So if you see some problems there, this is what you can do. What you will also see is that we have two new entries here for what we call the X-sharp custom editors. There are some options for the VO compatible window editor, and we have some options for the other editors in Visual Studio, like the parent class for the menu editor or the DB server editor. I'm not going to show these today because the editors haven't really changed. Well, a few small things, but you can find those in the What's New. So let's look at the compiler changes first, and I'm using this particular test program. And oh yeah, before I forget it, we also fixed the problem that many people have reported. So we can now debug 64-bit apps. And as you can see, the project compiler properties over here, the checkbox prefer 32-bit is not selected. So this is, should be running in 64-bit. And as you can see now, this dialog has also changed. We've changed from property-based options to a more painted way. And this is in preparation for our support for .NET Core projects. So we did the stuff just like you can also see in C#. We have similar layout. And if, for example, your application has classes, a static class that exposes static start method, then you can actually select an alternative startup object here. And there's many more options here that I'm not going to cover today, but some of them are from previously, and there are some new ones that I'll show in a minute. Okay, so first the 64-bit debugging. Let's see if it works. I'm gonna compile. It's the first time I compile this machine. Okay, so let's see, what do we get? What is int pointer size? And as you can see, int pointer size is 8, so we are debugging 64-bit. And come on. And we do see locals. So before this was a problem, locals were not working correctly, it crashed, we fixed that. So this is the first change we did that's really effective if you want to debug large applications. Okay, let's stop this. So what else did we change? Well, maybe you already noticed, but there's a new warning. And I know Fergus just said that he's seen this too. We got a request from some customers, so that's why we changed this. So if you think what a stupid change, then colleagues of you have asked for it. And the request was this: if you have, we have a stupid class here, but just to give you an example, we have a class with a method left and it calls the function left. Now, as you can see in this also updated quick info, this is the left function inside X-Sharp Core DLL. And this is the, this calls the left method in the class itself. Now, over here, this is, says this is a bit, the compiler warns that this is like not completely clear, because what do you want to call? Do you want to call the method in the class, or do you want to call the function in X-Sharp Core? What we do, we do the same thing that Fio does, we call the function if we are in doubt. And to be honest, in Fio, you would never, there would never be any ambiguity, because if you want to call the left method inside the class, you would always have to prefix it with self. Now, one of the customers asked is, okay, we want to see a warning like this, but we also want to be able to tell that we always want to prefix calls in the class with self to avoid this kind of ambiguity. And to do that, we've added the compiler option on the language page. It says enforce self, and you can select it here. The command line property is, well, that command is slash enforce self, as you can see in the tooltip here. And what you also can do, if you want to do this locally, you can use a pragma to set this option. So there are basically three ways to set this, either through the property dialog, or you specify a command line parameter. And this is what, if you want to enforce it locally. So when I do this, this means that I tell the compiler that if you do not put self in front of it, it must always be a function call or a static method call. And by doing this and recompiling, you will see that the warning message disappears. So if you see lots of these warning messages, of course you could disable the warning, but I would recommend you enable this compiler option and force self. And if you do it project-wide, then the best way to do it is through this particular option on the language page. If you want to do it restricted to certain files, you can use the pragma. It works both the same. Okay. What else? Yeah. We also got a request from customers to say, there's a lot of code on the web in C Sharp. It works similar, but not quite the same in X Sharp. And we are sometimes not sure how to translate. And this is a very popular one. We probably should even do like this. We have system datetime dot now dot toString. There are three dots in here. And let's put it this way, not all dots are alike. If you try to compile this in X Sharp, then it doesn't compile. And why doesn't it compile? Well, to begin with, this particular project is in the dialect visual objects. And in visual objects, we use the colon as send operator. So the colon is used to send, to have an operation where the left-hand side of the colon is an object and the right-hand side is a property or a method. Now, in this case, the compiler thinks that this must be, cannot be an object because it has a dot here. And in the VO dialect, if this was an object or a structure, then there should have been a colon. Since there's a dot here, it says, okay, the left-hand side must be type because that's where we use the dot for in the VO dialog. And that's why the compiler complains that the type name now does not exist in the system.datetime. So apparently this is C-sharp code and it doesn't compile. The real way to compile this in the VO dialect, if I do it the full name like this, then you have a dot here to say date time is in the system namespace. So this date, this dot says date time is part of the system namespace. This dot says now is a static field or property in the date time type. And the colon says we're going to call a method on this property or field which returns a date time object. So this is how we do it in VO, but it's confusing if you haven't, if you have to copy code from the web or if you're mixing languages, this could be confusing. But this is the way it compiles in VO. What the, one of the customers asks is, can you guys not change the compiler to also allow this? So to also allow dots for instance methods or instance properties. And since we are creating our compiler on top of Roslyn, it was actually less work to also support the dot than to support the colon because Roslyn already knows how this works. What we did is we added a compiler option called project or called allow dot. It's also again on the language page. Just allow dot for instance members, which can also be set with a pragma. So I'm doing it with a pragma now. It's not the easiest way to do it, but it's just that you see in code that is actually using this feature. And when I enable that, I can now use both syntaxes. The colon is still supported, but we can, you can also use the dot now for the toString method. Is it good? Is it bad? You can argue about it. I personally like the colon instead of the dot because it tells me that this is an object and this is the method. And I can put this as a watch expression in the debugger if I want. And if you put the, so it has a value basically. Where of course this cannot be put in the watch window because it doesn't have a value, it's a type. Is it good, is it bad? I don't know. We did add it and it's supported now. So we just want to give you that option. It's up to you to decide whether you want to use this or not, whether you want to use it, but we support it anyway. What do you guys think of this? Was this a good addition or are you guys cursing us now because we did this? Anyone want to give feedback? No?
Well, I guess it cannot hurt.
Yes, it cannot hurt. Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
It's a nice possibility to put together a bit the two worlds, the C-sharp and X-sharp.
Especially if you develop code on both sides. So you have parts of your system in C-sharp and part in X-sharp, you would get confused. So that's why I think this is a very, it was relatively easy to implement. I think it was one of your colleagues, Anna, who asked for it and it was less than a day work. So we decided, okay, let's do it. We already were supporting this in the Foxflow dialect and in the core dialect. And if you run the core or Foxflow dialect of X-Sharp, the allow dot is enabled by default. So you do not have to switch it on, but you can switch it off. So if you want to have the core dialect without the dot, you can switch it off too. And if you want to do the Foxpro dialect without the dot, you can also switch it off. Okay, something else that I want to show here is, by the way, did you guys see that the quick info now has images and has word wrapping? So it looks a bit better. It's not perfect yet. I want to have the image on the other place, but since I'm Mr. Data and not Mr. GUI, Fabrice will probably have to come and clean that up, but we'll get there. Good. Something else that we added that I'd like to show is local functions. Briefly, because we already shown that in another online video. I have a test here with a function called test local func. I have a local I as long. I'm going to loop through and calculate squares. And I have a local function square here. Let's run this through the debugger and then play a bit with this. Okay, we're inside test local func. You can see it on the call stack, test local func line 40. And I'm going to step in. Now I'm inside square. And as you can see, square has also the variable I. It's not declared in square, it's not a parameter. So the local function can actually access local variables from its containing scope. So this is useful, but also tricky. So you can argue whether it should have, we should have passed I as a parameter or not, but it's not necessary. The compiler does a special trick to make I visible inside square as well. On the call stack, you see that the function looks different. So I should probably change this font a bit for the people at home. Let's see. This is locals window 14. Stop it. No, I probably need to do Visual Studio again. I'm not going to restart Visual Studio. But if you look at this and do this at home, you will see that test local func shows like a normal name, and the square function shows like less than test local func, greater than g square, and something else, line 45. So it actually is not a real function. And this is important. The local function works like a normal function, just like you have in Pascal, but it is not saved as a function in the metadata. So you cannot use reflection to call it. If you look at the generated IL, which I'm not doing now, but I recommend if you want to see what it does, this is actually like a named lambda. So it's a lambda expression with a name. And it has access to the variables from its surrounding scope. And the compiler does the same trick that it does for lambda expressions. So it somehow wraps these variables in a special structure and passes the structure both to the square function and to the test local func, which surrounds it. So they both have access to the same variables. I'll let it run. See that the results are right. You can see it does know how to square. But in this case, I didn't pass the parameters. Of course, what you could also do was and if you forget to pass the parameter, you will get the normal error message. There's no argument given because I didn't pass it here. And now I didn't put the break debugger in there. Sorry. I removed my breakpoint. And now you will see if you enter the square function, you don't no longer see the I. You no longer see the local from its scope around it, but you only see the parameter that was passed in. So now inside square, you cannot access I. It's invisible. So it's a choice what you do. Either you make it like an independent function, a normal function, or you allow it to access its parent variables. It's up to you. In C sharp, they call the variant that doesn't have access to its parents locals, they call it a static local function. And in C sharp, you can actually put the static keyword there, not in any version of C sharp, but in the latest version. We'll probably add that too in the next build. So this tells the compiler that you do not want it to touch the locals from its surrounding scope. So it's like a safety guard. You want to make sure that you're passing all the parameters and you're not accidentally touching something from the surrounding scope. You can make it a static local function. And it's static in the sense that there's no, you could call the I instance data basically, although this is a function, but that's the idea. I think it's useful. Don't overuse it, but it's useful to have small helper methods or small helper functions. We discussed whether we should also have local methods. We decided not. We said in this case, this will probably local function will work. By the way, local procedure works too. Of course, if you do it just like this, you will have to have, first, you cannot have to return a value, and second, the names must match. But we do support local procedure. One difference with normal functions and normal procedures is that everything must be strongly typed. There's no clipper calling convention. Most important reason for that is that to do clipper calling convention, we are adding attributes to the functions or the methods. And since this is not metadata for this, we cannot put attributes on it. So that's why we basically cannot do it. And since this is a new feature, it was probably a good idea to do it solely typed anyway. Okay. The third thing I want to show in the compiler, you've already seen it, but I didn't mention it. If you look at this particular piece of code, we are supporting what's called, expression membered bodies. I'm not sure who invents those names, but and it is the idea that you can specify a property or a method, and you do not specify a body, but using this equals greater than symbol, you actually specify the body inline. So you could also have done something like this. This compiles and it makes it the perfect method. This is actually the same as, so does it really make a difference? Is it really much less code? I don't know, but we thought it was nice to support it because the compiler supports it. And sometimes you want to have simple one-liners, but of course we could already do one-liners like this. It also works. It's just another syntax for doing the same. The final one that we've added is a new operator. It's called the null coalescing operator and the coalesce assignment statement. And the operator is the question mark operator. So you can do something like s value equals test me. If you write it like this, you say, okay, sorry, I want to assign the result of test me, but if the result is null, I want to assign a default value. And with null, I mean an object reference, null. So not null string. And this works for that reason for all reference types. And if you have this operator, you can, the equivalent of that in an assignment is this one. So question mark equals. And what this does says S value equals S value, but if S value was null before, then assign the default string. Let's take this one out and let's see what it does. Compile. So I'm going to test me. Now, I know the test me only returns a null, but it's declared a string. So when I get back, S value is null, but this particular coalesce assignment statement will now see if S value is null, then assign it default string. It's just a simple way of doing things in one line. If you get used to it, this is, I think, cleaner than having an IIF expression or having an if statement. It's just a simple instruction. Behind the scenes, there's no difference. So it does check for null. And so it is implemented like an if expression or if statement, sorry, or an IIF expression. But it's just cleaner, basically. These are about the compiler changes that I want to show. Are there any questions about this? You guys missing something that we need to add in the next build? This is the moment, right? We are now open now for all your suggestions. Or are you all happy with what we have at the moment? I think no message means you're all happy, right?
We want tuples. Tuples. What's the name?
Tuples.
Yeah.
Do you want tuples?
Yeah.
Okay. What will the syntax be for a tuple then? Is it something like
the parentheses? I think it's fine.
Yeah.
Maybe explain.
Something like this.
Yeah.
And then
maybe explain to people what that means.
Okay. What is a tuple? Is a special type which returns more than one value, basically. And tuples already exist because you can do this. Yeah. This is a tuple type which returns basically two values. And within the tuple, you have item one and item two in this case. There is an alternative syntax which has been introduced in C#. It does it like this. And if you want to assign it, you do something like this.
Robert, just let me say that it's a nice way to return two things from a function, or return three things from a function.
Exactly, without doing out parameters or stuff like that. And if you want to return two or three things, you also need to assign it to two or three variables. Now, the syntax that C# uses is something like this. So you're returning two variables. What you can do in C#, and we'll probably do something similar, is say, I'm actually only interested in the Y. You do it like this. You give it the underscore, which is what they call the discard identifier. It says an identifier for something that you know will be thrown away. So you don't give it a name, basically. And we'll probably do something like this too. Or, of course, this should work to them. And this should also be allowed. But in this case, this is kind of stupid because then you can just do foo and it's just the same. Any function call already, when you do not catch its return value, you actually can just call it on the line. If you use FoxPro, you would have to use this. But we will support this unless we come up with a better result. And of course, over here, it should do something like so this should then be the return value. So probably a syntax like this. I think it could be useful, yes, if you want to return more than one thing. The alternative, of course, if you want to return more than one thing, is to do it like this with an anonymous type. But then how do you declare the return type of the function? That's more difficult. And with the tuple support, the return type is obvious, is documented. You do not have to give the fields a name. You assign it to a variable like this or multiple variables and you get the results there. This is probably not going to be in the May release, but maybe in June or July. For May, we are working on several issues that were reported with regard to the runtime and Visual Studio. But yeah, exactly, it's strongly typed, that's good, and it's useful. And yeah, what people have done, Joe writes that, is return an array, and then assign it. This is what many people have done. And then but of course var will in this case will declare usuals because array elements are usual. So that's you would then have to cast it. And you see this much more ugly than doing it this elegant var xy syntax. Okay, good. Let's skip the compiler for now and move on. I know we have FoxPro people watching, so let's look at some FoxPro code. This particular project compiles in the FoxPro dialect, as you can see, and it has normal FoxPro option set, though late binding is supported, memvar support, undeclared variables, allow dot for instance members, because in FoxPro everything uses dots. So let's have a look at some samples. The first one is FoxPro array support. No. What is this? Compiling the wrong thing. Okay. Inside this function now, you see that we support the FoxPro dimension statement. And this dimension statement creates an array of 10 elements. We could have done it with parentheses too in the dimension statement. Assigning 42, string in this case, to the array is like filling all the array elements with 42. Now, on the bottom, on the locals window, you do not see the array because it's declared with dimension and it's a private variable. And at this moment, we do not have private variables in the locals window yet. We have a solution for that that I'll show you later, but so unfortunately, you do not see them yet. There would be a way to do it by calling a runtime function, but let's not do that for now. I'm just assigning two variables and let's see it in the debugger. And as you can see, let's increase the font a bit. As you can see, all elements are 42, except element 1 and 10, which I have been assigned with 1 and 10. Now I'm mixing types, so 2 to 9 are strings, 1 is a number, and 10 is a string as well. That's the way you can do it in FoxPro, and that's the way you can do it in XSharp 2. Now then I'm redimensioning the array. So adim1 is redimensioned to 5,2. And then I'm going to use the new ALEN functions for FoxPro that says I'm going to determine the number of columns and the number of rows. And I'm looking at the information. And as you can see, these numbers are the same as these numbers. So if you redimension the array, the contents of the array is saved. I think that's cool. It is a bit because FoxPro uses doesn't really have dynamic arrays that we have in Clipper or Visual Objects, but they have kind of static arrays. And the 5,2 is just indicating that there must be not one column, but two columns, and the number of elements is still 10. So this retrieves the information like the way it was before. So I'm going to do an example of a two-dimensional array that was created new, and I'm going to declare it with 3,4, and I'm filling it with 0, setting 2 elements, and as you can see, 1,1 is 11, 3,4 is 34, and all the others are 0. So we do support the FoxPro arrays now. We support the functions like ALEN, but there's many more. What we don't support, I know you're going to ask for it, is the parentheses, come on, over here, yet. We did support it in the previous build, but it was broken and it gave problems resolving at compile time with the functions with similar names. And for now, we've disabled it. It'll come back in the next build or the build after that. What we also are going to support, but it's broken at this moment, is local array, idim1. It compiles now, but it doesn't really work. There's a problem here. So we're going to fix that for the next build, but the dimension works. Okay. Let's look at the second one. What else did we add? I'm going to briefly touch scripting. We added accept script support. Now this is of course a stupid script. It just adds two numbers, but you can do anything in the script, including use statements, go tops, whatever you want. And I did a demo, I think in February, of the new accept script support. This is also part of the 2.8 build now. So it just goes far too show that, but it is working. The test script is based on the full macro compiler. So in my sample here, I have linked in X-Sharp macro compiler full, X-Sharp scripting, and X-Sharp code analysis. If you delete X-Sharp code analysis from the GEC, like I have shown before, and then you must put a hard reference in there, because otherwise the runtime will not be able to find it. When we fix the installer and we put the right versions of the assemblies in the GEC, then on your development machine, you do not have to install that, put the reference in here. At runtime, of course, you must make sure that these files are available and these files are located in the read disk folder, and you must copy macro compiler and code analysis and scripting to your output folder when you deploy it to a customer's machine. But if you do that, then you can use it. Our colleague Nikos, who's not online now, is working on a version of the XXScript support that's not based on the Roslyn code. So it doesn't, you don't need X-Sharp code analysis and the macro compiler full, and is faster. But it's not finished yet. So we are not including that yet because, for example, it doesn't support user-defined commands. So it doesn't support a use statement or a go top statement. But it'll come in one of the next builds. It'll support the preprocessor and it'll support anything. So that would make it better than this one, with one disadvantage that inside the macro compiler full, you can even declare functions and classes. And in the script support that Nikos is working on, we will not support that. So that will be just statements. Okay. Look at the script session that we in our YouTube channel to see more examples, but you can do almost everything you want with scripts that you can do in Foxtrot 2. Then we had a contribution from some guys on our website, and they contributed the bit functions, so bit AND, bit OR, bit XOR. I'm not sure what it all does, but it seems to work, and they've created unit tests, and the results are, it does ANDs and ORs. The O, H notation are binary values. So we have binary value support in our product, and binary value is it's something like a array of bytes, basically, but it's a different way to fill these array of bytes. And you can use bit operations on those, but you can also have bit operations on numbers. So this is a binary 0H, which is basically an empty binary. And if you AND it, you will get you get this particular value, I hope. Yeah, as you can see. And if you OR it, you get complete value. So this just works. If you find problems in this code, let us know. But I think we are fairly confident almost everything that you expect works here, because the guy who wrote it, I think it was Antonio who did this, actually tests everything also on the FoxPro side and gets the same results. Something else we added in this build, it's not rocket science, it's not the best thing on the world, but it's functions like caps lock and numlock and insert mode. Now, as you can see, caps is on, off, sorry, a numlock is on. It challenges me to switch it, so I'm going to press numlock and caps lock, and I press an insert. And now you can see numlock has been stripped, caps lock has been switched, and insert has been switched. Now, there is a challenge with insert, since insert mode is not a system-wide state, but it's something that your application needs to keep track of. So if I switch insert mode on and I run the app again, then you will see that NumFalse caps 2 has been remembered, but insert starts with false again. So this is something that is not a global state from the machine, but it's basically application state. And Karl-Heinz is working on a better way to support this in the future. But for now, you can keep track of that information. There's other stuff in 2.8 for Fox Pro 2. I would recommend you have a look at the README to see some kind of stuff that we've added. Final thing that I want to demonstrate is a changed version of our VOMDI framework, which shows what we call runtime debugging support. And let's have a look. In the menu here, we've added debug menu for work areas, global settings, and memory variables, both in the empty shell window and in the standard shell menu. So let's run the app. This is a normal VO compatible window. And let's have a look at debug work areas. Well, we haven't opened anything, so this is empty. That makes sense. We have a debug globals. Shows you all the globals that are accessible from within the app. So these are all public globals. So we can see that XSharp RT has a delegate, which is public. I'm not sure whether Chris, well, we actually want this delegate to be public, but it is there. And the GUI classes have a couple of public globals too. One is new, it's introduced in this build. It's the class name for the default form dialog, which is by default this __ form dialog window. If you want to change the behavior of all data window form dialogs, you can change this particular global, give it your class name, and the GUI classes will use that instead of the __ form dialog window. The same is for the browser. GSIM browser dev already existed. This specifies the class name that's used if you're going to do browse the table. So let's browse the table. I have a copy of the Northwind database over here. As you can see, I didn't include the VO container DLLs. And as a result, this is set to data list view because it couldn't find the container DLLs. And now we've opened the table, we should also see a work area. Okay. There's something wrong, but it's still working. I'm not sure what's wrong. Okay. Houston, we found a problem. Anyway, this should show you, but it doesn't. So there's a problem here. Should show you the indexes. Let's try to open another file. Now it does. Okay, so you see the index that was opened with the name and the condition, when there's a condition. These don't have a condition. There's a problem with the customer index, but actually you do see it now. You see this particular one, company name. Does it match company name here? Because this is a FoxPro DBC based table, which has a longer name, but it is recognized and it is parsed and it is visible. And in the bottom, I should know better than to press this button.
Yeah, admit I didn't test this feature before release. It's what you do yourself, you never test it.
So this this basically gives you the opportunity to browse through the data in the debugger. Now, we intend to put this window and the other window as a window in the Visual Studio Debugger 2, and probably this is something similar like this is already in XIDE. We also added a window that shows you all the global states, the global settings that are stored in the XSharp runtime state. stuff like the code page, color. This is still something that we have from Clipper. Foxtrot has that too, the default IDD. You see it, the error block when it's there. If there wasn't the last file that it used, if you use the file function in X-Sharp, it stores the last file that was found in there and other stuff. So this is really useful, I think, that you can see. For, at this moment, you cannot change these values. It would not be really difficult to make this changeable too, but it's probably something we'll add in a later version. And there's memory variables. Now, of course, to have memory variables, you need to declare them first. So have a look at the source code of the app. And you can see that in the start function, I'm declaring a public default dir, and I'm setting it to curdir. And in the standard shell, I'm declaring a myprivate, setting it to 42. So that's why inside the app, I'm seeing a public with the name default dir and a private with the name 42. Now, if you would open this window with the example that does a FoxPro array with the dimension statement, you would see the array here too. So this is basically showing you all the privates that are visible from within this place in the code. What's important is to realize that these are for the current thread. The same is true for the settings. These are also for the current thread and for the work areas, which are not open now, but this is also for the current thread. The globals, however, are not thread-based. They are, would they work for all the threads, basically. Okay. Did I forget anything? Let's see, what did I have? Yeah, I have an announcement to make that I didn't mention before. We had some requests from VO users to support Sven Ebert's SEUIXP. We've been in contact with Sven, and we are going to indeed support this product, and we are also going to sell a X-Sharp version of SEUIXP through our shop. So people who use this in VO and want to have these sexy windows appear in X-Sharp 2, we will help you with that. If you have a Vulkan version of SEUIXP, you will get a free upgrade. And if you have the VO version, you will have to pay a small upgrade price. I think the price will be 99 euros. But for that, you will get these sexy looking toolbars and menus. That's one thing that I want to mention. Yeah, additionally, some people have already used it, but I would like to show you this new feature. Many of you have code like this. Everywhere in your app. We are supporting the task list window in over here. And in this task window, we are adding commands, and the commands you can declare in Visual Studio in the task list over here. There are actually a couple of predefined keywords, hack to do undone and all unresolved merge conflicts, or this one you can delete. And it looks for these. And you can see that it, based on information on this dialogue, it sets an icon. So if I say, you will get another icon. And from what I know, you can probably filter here on this icon or sort it. It's a priority. So this is there. At this moment, in 2.8, we're actually not checking if hack or todo is part of a name. So it even includes it, and it also includes it when it's not the first word on the line. But one of the colleagues from Arne has analyzed what C# does and has given us some hints, and we will do the same in X#, so you can have the same rules, which means that it has to be the first word on the line to be included. This is going to be part of the May release. I've already coded it and it works. So from then on, the first word of a comment that's to do hack or undone, but you can add your own, will be used for the task list. It also works on multi-line comments. It also can also include it. I think Chris has added this in IDE2, so I think it's cool that we support it now on both sides. It's almost 5 o'clock. I'm almost there.
Robert, one more thing maybe about the new error handling, which is similar to VO now.
What do you mean?
With the abort, retry, ignore dialogue.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, true. Error handling. Let's introduce an error, right?
Yeah.
This should generate an error, right? That we know about. Okay, we have a new error dialog now. With this part of the X# VO assembly, if I'm correct, but you may correct me, Chris. This now
shows
you similar information that you have in VO. We've added copy to clipboard, which is useful. So you can copy it and mail it to us if you want. We have, when the error has the property can retry, the retry button will be enabled. In this case, can retry is false. You can do abort, which will quit the app. It doesn't. Yeah, it does. I was just too impatient. Or I can press ignore. And in this case, it aborts. That's probably because I don't have a begin sequence end. What's different now is that if you look, where's my window? There should be an error log here somewhere. It's not. Where is the error log? It should produce an error log, but I don't see it.
Good point. I was seeing it, but
yeah, but it's I'm probably looking in the wrong folder. It does produce an error log, but I'm not sure whether the right folder is located now. So this is part of it writes similar error log file that VO does. Now, the way it does it sets the error block, the startup, and you can override that and call it. And of course, since everything is open source, the code to this error handler is also there. I think we made it internal to X-Sharp RT, most of it, but you can easily look at GitHub and look at the code and adjust it to your own needs when you want. But we do have this, and it does give you the opportunity, for example, to copy it to clipboard, and then so you have the problem from the code. Okay, good. Yes, thank you, Chris, for reminding me. And I would suggest look at what's new. It's a lot in there. I just covered only a bit of it. Many functions, many classes were improved. For example, one thing that I didn't mention, but we have serialization support now built into usual and binary, so you can use a JSON serializer and save this if you want. Binary serializer works always. For usual, the JSON serializer is a bit of a trick because JSON makes strings of everything and it's a bit difficult to restore the original value from the string, but we do our best. But it is, we put the stuff in there. If you find that it's, you're missing a bit, let us know. If you have suggestions of how to improve it, it's really welcome. Finally, something that if you work in a team could be useful is, let's see if I can find it. No, I forgot to put a template in there. We support .editor.config files. There's a whole chapter about it in the help file, which also has been improved. Editor.config, you can find a lot about editor.config on editor.config.org. It's a standard for various IDEs to document in source code what your preferences are for indenting, tab space, and in our case also keyword case, align, do case, etc. So we follow that now, which means that if you set options in your editor settings, for example, you tell it to use tabs and tab size 3, but you have an editor config file in your solution that says no, use spaces and 4, then this editor config file will take preference over the settings in your individual Visual Studio IDE. That means that if the person coordinating the project decides that everybody should use spaces and space delimiter of 4 and should, for example, use uppercase keywords and trim trailing white space, you can set it in the editor config and the editor will use that and not the settings from the individual's tools options dialog. This could help keeping these kind of settings consistent in your projects. And especially if you're working as a consultant and you're working for company A, which uses spaces and 3, and company B will use tabs and 4, as long as they put your editor config in their solutions, you will not break the rules. So I think it's a valuable addition. And we will add new features there. We are planning to improve the editor formatting and give you more options similar to what C# has. So they have all kinds of options like, let's see, do you want to have, you can specify how this works and how that, all these options. We don't have a team as big as C#, so it's going to take a while before we put it all in there, but we're going to make the formatting more configurable. And when we put that in, we will also put that into the editor config so you can enforce the same coding standard over the whole team. I think I've covered almost everything I wanted to discuss today. Like I said, it's not everything that was in 2.8. There is a new 2.8 coming. So I expect in a week or 2 weeks, we will do a new installer, fixes a couple of the urgent issues found by customers and fixes the installer problem with the debug version of two assemblies being registered in the global assembly cache. But there will be no major change, I think, in the runtime. Just a few changes in the compiler and the installer. Okay. Does anybody have questions? I'm going to stop sharing my screen so we can see each other.
There's a
big
text,
round.
There's a text question, Robert.
Let's see, where is my chat window? Oh yeah, I didn't mention it, Stefan, but yes, using FAR is implemented. It's working. So that's in this, I should have shown it, but it's already there. So you do not have to begin using VAR and using, but using VAR works. And it sets, basically, it's implemented as it begins using from that line on until the end of the current scope. So if the using VAR is inside a begin sequence, for example, it will be until the recover. If it's within the try catch, it will be within the try block. And if it's, for example, in a for next, it'll be it will end at the next line. Okay. Anyone else? I think you answered all the questions so far. Yeah. Okay. Well, then I would like to thank you all for your attention. It was good to see so many of you online. Fabrice has promised to finish his migration session for Fox Pro, so it's ready in May. He put his camera on, so you can see him, and you can see that he's smiling. I'm not sure whether the smile means, oh yeah, Robert, come on. You know it's not going to be ready, or whether it's a confident smile says, yeah, I'm sure I will finish it before the end of May. Well, Fabrice, you can at least show us then work in progress, right? The current state.
Currently, forms library menus are exported and are linked together. So let's say that the export effort is, I think, arriving to an end. I just have to check that the length of the event, especially from menu, is okay, but mostly it is running fine, let's say.
Cool, yeah. And next week, there is another virtual FoxFest. We will be there with a virtual booth. Everything is virtual nowadays. So we will try to get more FoxPro people on board, and that helps us also justify to spend more time there. So that's what we have. And I see a question from Bernard Meyer about the XS2ADO compiling problem. It's a bit like what Chris said before with the debugger dialogues. You always test your own code last. So XS2ADO wasn't really tested, and I'm going to make sure that within the next few days I'll fix that, and the fix to that will be included in the patch for next week. So yes, I will have a look at that, but I haven't really so far. So my apologies, but we'll fix it next week. And you can still use the pre-compiled DLL that came with the product, because we didn't change the runtime. So the third-party controls wouldn't work anymore. But I'll kind of make sure that it compiles. It's probably something silly that breaks the compiler, because I've seen, in your messages that the compiler aborts and doesn't tell you what's wrong. Well, I have the advantage that I have the compiler source, so I can see where it aborts and probably fix it. And hope that I can prevent it from aborting in the future. Okay, any other questions? Speak now, or the saying. No, then I would like to thank you all for your attention, and we'll see each other either next week at the virtual FoxFest or next month at another online session. Okay, have a nice day, and on behalf of the team, thanks you a lot.
Goodbye.